Hi, I'm April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome to CAS Reads Big, an interview series with authors who are visiting our campus to lecture on their most recent works. My guest today is Mr. Tony Lewis Jr., community activist, ex-offender counselor, outreach worker, and founder of Sons of Life, a non-for-profit that mentors and advocates for children of incarcerated parents. He is visiting UDC today to talk about his book, Slugg, A Boy's Life in the Age of Mass Incarceration. Mr. Lewis, welcome back to your alma mater, and thank you so much for being with me today.
Thank you for having me.
So, you graduated from UDC in 2004.
Yes, yes.
And you kind of hit the ground running with your life in terms of really understanding as a very young man what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
A lot of that was shaped by your early life. Can you talk a little bit about how you found such a clear path for yourself at such a young age, and how that culminated in the book and the place in your life that you are now?
Yeah, I think which was very interesting is that I didn't have a ton of clarity, or as much clarity as it appears. And I come from a place where, unfortunately, many of my peers die young. So when I did receive got clarity, in a regular sense or normal sense, I was very young. But for where I come from, it was like I wasn't as young as, you know, we grow up fast. So my time here at the University of the District of Columbia really was the time from 19 to 23, 24, was when I really gained that clarity. Mm-hmm. It was through classes, and I had got a job working as a youth outreach worker, sort of on a peer-to-peer relationship. And that work, being in the community, relating to young people, being able to redirect negative energy into positive actions with the young people, it really saved me, I think, because it showed me my gift. It introduced me to my gift. And from there, I got serious about school. I got serious about life. And then, like you said, after that, things just kind of took off from there.
You lived in D.C. and
yes.
around D.C.
Yes.
at a time when we were known to be one of the worst cities in the United States to actually reside in.
Yeah.
And in the book, you describe that city, the city that you knew as a young man, 8, 9, 10 years old, from very different perspectives. You knew it as a place where there was real community for you and the people that you loved.
Yes.
But you also knew it where there was real potential for harm. You knew crime.
Sure.
You knew pain. So why don't you talk a little bit about Slugg at 9 and Mr. Tony Lewis now looking back at his 9-year-old self.
Wow. Slugg at 9 was a kid that was the only child, a kid that was spoiled, a kid that had loving parents. That would all of a sudden be events would occur that would take that stability away from him, strip him of his innocence, and force him into an existence that was full of uncertainty and misdirection, you know, just not knowing what was next. And so, but all in all, a smart kid, a relatively happy child. And then looking back, it's like I often, as a 35-year-old man, as a father, I pain for that kid because, I mean, I look at what happened, how differently things happened, how quickly it happened. And that kid didn't have any real buffer or protection from what was going on. He was going through exactly what his parents was going through. He was watching his father be in shackles on TV, be in court on TV. He was watching his mother cry constantly. He was watching his, you know, all of his family members that used to smile all the time, not smile anymore, mm-hmm. and trying to figure out why. All the while, you know, going to school and just trying to be a normal kid, mm-hmm. moving from, you know, a suburban community back to, you know, the neighborhood that he derived from. A neighborhood that was definitely familiar because he was there a lot, but still, mm-hmm. it was just a change, a total change for this kid. So, that's a very profound question with me looking back on my 9-year-old self, you know, I really feel for that kid because, he would then go through a lot. Right. Yeah.
So let's put 9-year-old Slug's life in perspective by looking at your mom and what was happening with her, and then looking at your dad and what was happening with him. So when I read through the book and I'm thinking about all that your mom was experiencing, there's something that you say that I think that if people don't take anything else away from this book, I would hope they not miss this. Mm-hmm. You said that as your mom was beginning to unravel, and you were 9, you didn't really understand, but you heard her having the hallucinations. You heard her, you were witnessing this. You couldn't explain it, she couldn't explain it, she was denying it, nobody in the family, and you said, that when you think about it now and you look at it, and the reason that initially nobody would even give credence to the fact something was wrong was because mental health issues were so common in the community but not given a name or a face. So when you think about it, your mom was dealing with interracial issues because she was dealing with colorism. Mm-hmm. You talk about that she was a very brown woman who was dealing with colorism. That was made worse by the fact that your father had recently chosen a new girlfriend who was considerably lighter. Mm-hmm. That your mom was also dealing with image issues around weight, and she was purging, and so she clearly was experiencing anorexia and or bulimia before we even really had names for them, and that we believe that black women didn't do those things. She clearly was dealing with the beginnings of a psychotic break. So talk to me about 9-year-old Slug with mom and Tony Lewis and mom.
Well, with my mother at 9, it was like, my mother was very completely loving. She was completely immersed with me. Like, again, I spoke that I was the only child, but it was like, I guess some people use the term overprotective, you know, doted on me, gave me anything that I wanted. We spent all of our time together, you know, when I wasn't away. I mean, I spent all of my time with my mother. But at the same time, witnessing, you know, her fight, my mother fight her demons, so to speak, you know, from the, you know, the purging to her having conversations with people that weren't there. And I do want to say this though, given my dad's lifestyle, some of that paranoia was very warranted. Absolutely. We lived in a time where families were getting kidnapped, you know, children were getting kidnapped, people's houses were getting ran into, and people were getting held for ransom and things of that nature. And my mother, she came from that world. So she had a very clear, concise understanding of what was possible in that regard. And the last thing that she would want, not only something happened to her, but mainly her child, which was me. She was a mother who made me focus on education. My mother didn't really, she never really, on the discipline side of things, the two things, she wasn't like someone who would be constantly like on my back, but when it came to school and homework and respecting adults, some of the things that I feel like have carried me through my life, that was her. So that was me and my mother at 9. And not to mention seeing her and my father, they had a ton of domestic issues. They would fight a ton. And again, I'm the only child. I was there for everything. There was no go in the room, and you know, everything that happened right in front of me. So I also saw her deal with that at the time. It was interesting, too, because sometimes, to me, I was ignorant to relationships in fidelity or infidelity, you know. So to me, it would seem as if she was the person that would, you know, be the aggressor or start these conversations. And all I would want was for her not to do that so Dad can stay, so Dad wouldn't leave, right? So... But I would hear the things that they would say back and forth to each other. And it was just interesting because some of the individuals that will be accused back and forth in terms of the infidelity, I knew them as well. Again, so this 9-year-old kid is kind of absorbing all of this. But the great thing about my childhood is that I saw my parents. I never really saw my parents be affectionate with each other. And I actually get into that in the book as well about when I saw my dad and my stepmother embrace on a jail visit. I had never seen him be that loving with my mother, and it bothered me. But I always felt loved by both of them. And so I'm very grateful for that. I never felt like either my parents didn't love or care about me immensely, because I knew that they did. Everything that they did showed me that, I mean, in terms of it towards me. But I didn't really see them love each other.
So let's talk about mom a little bit more. You mentioned in the book that mom didn't finish high school.
She did not. She dropped out in 11th
grade. She nurtured a kid.
Yes.
Who they insisted on private school through senior high. And you came to UDC about a year after your high school graduation. And in under five years, you exit magna cum laude. And you have not only a credential, a bachelor's degree, but you also took advantage of the certificate in nonprofit leadership.
Yes.
And you were very clear about how you were going to use all of those things. So on the one hand, you describe an environment that had its own level of chaos, but there was for you a level of calm and direction that kept you moving in very unique ways relative to some of the kids around you.
Question.
So talk about mom and that role, because they read to you at night. They
flashcarded me to death at an early age. My mother would read to me. She would force me to do flashcards. My dad, I couldn't watch cartoons, and it's crazy because I know it's these kind of crazy perceptions of who people are, especially when you're in the drug game, you from the ghetto, whatever. My dad watched the news like religiously, so. For over dinner or in the evening, I couldn't watch cartoons. I would watch the news, and we would watch National Geographic and things of that nature. And again, I think my mother, with her not finishing school, I think for her it was she knew that was a bad decision that she made. But my grandmother sent them to Catholic school. She felt she knew that she was, I think, smarter than what her education level would say. And so for me, I think she just wanted me not to ever make that kind of mistake. She really valued education, as you can see, in those habits that she helped me create, carried me all the way through my schooling. Because, I mean, when I get to eighth grade, by seventh, eighth grade, I don't have her anymore in the way that I had her before. But the values that she instilled in me, and also the respect that I had for her in terms of wanting to still make her proud no matter what she may have been going through. And my dad as well was there, and it helped me. I was very lucky in that way. But I had extremely loving parents, and I had a real strong foundation. That's why I think somebody's life from 0 to 9, it's so important. It's so important.
Absolutely. So let's talk about dad.
Yeah.
So 9-year-old Slugg, you see your father for the first time shackled.
Yeah.
You see him in that cage, and it breaks your heart. You can't even imagine how you go from Largo to that.
Yep.
So talk about how you emerged from just that gloom to be able to use those visits and those phone calls that you had with your dad, because you talk a lot about the phone calls, to really help you keep your life together and keep your relationship with dad together. Can you talk about that some?
Yeah, I can remember early on in his incarceration, when my mother sat me down and told me the importance of writing him letters. I remember she telling me that he needed that, like it would help him. And I can remember a conversation with him telling me that he would need me to be strong. So my young mind, what that meant is that I had to honor my parents. I had to continue to listen to them in a way, even if they weren't there physically, and I had to support them. It was like, in a way, a sort of role reversal, at least in my mind. I was calling myself, doing what was best for them. And then through the years, as I grew up, obviously life happens, and you're faced with challenges and decisions that, in the community like the one I came up in, you're faced with life and death situations all the time. But the relationship I had with my dad and those phone calls, they meant so much. And what he would talk to me about the horrors of prison and about him wanting better for me and not coming there, not letting my mom and him down. Just for me, it kind of gave me motivation to continue to do what I thought they would want me to do. And then obviously I had my grandmother there and my aunt there and my uncles for some reinforcement. But the driving factor was that I just wanted to make my parents proud. And I knew what they wanted for me, even if they weren't necessarily physically there in the way that they once were to guide me. And that's when the problems came in a way, though. I always had the right mindset, but it's like, how do you do it? You know, That's what, you know, that's what you, I had to figure that out. Right. How does it happen? I had no models for it, you know, none at all. So that created a big gap.
Right.
Yeah.
You talk about in the opening pages of the book about the sense of community on Hanover Place. As chaotic as it was, as much confusion, and that it clearly was a crime scene waiting to happen every day, all day. But in that, you found fun and laughter and love and community, and you talked about being a young kid who was never asked to be a lookout, never expected that that would be something that you would do, but yet you took pride in being a part of the boys that hollered out. So I think that is very interesting, and a lot of readers, I think, would walk away with the same kind of question. Juxtaposing that sense of community and the humanity that even operated within that. When you talked about one of the people in the line to buy drugs who was beaten with the bat because something had happened, you didn't know what, but your dad said he took something that didn't belong to him. So there was a real sense of justice, and there was a real sense of humanity. There was a sense of protocol within parts of that life. But there were other parts of that life that were absolutely brutal and senseless, and that culture preyed on the weakness, the addiction of a large segment of that same community. So when you think about those, how do you juxtapose those in a way that helps you kind of rationalize that in a way that helps people just be sane around it?
Yeah. I think that what you just pointed out in terms of the humanity that's expressed on the page is what allows one to say that people making bad decisions don't make them bad people, because you know other layers and other sides to them. So it allows you to be, in my mind, honest though about everything that happened. So in a lot of times the tales of communities like the one I come from is only on that, you know, these bad guys are doing bad things. Mm-hmm. But it's deeper than that. And sometimes that's what the people that aren't a part of that subculture sometimes feel like, well, why are these guys beloved? Like, why do people look at them? Mm-hmm. But because there's other parts of them that the people that live there experience. It's a tough thing to try to wrap your mind around, though, because at the same time, you must acknowledge the sheer you know, trauma and violations to the community that are happening. But when you talk about the addiction or in the dealer, sometimes those people are brothers and sisters, right? So you're saying those people are coming out of the same household. And when you're from there, you see that those people are trying to escape this existence, right, through different means. And so you have a level of understanding about how it happens that allows you to say simply, this is what happened in its entirety. And for me, through Slugg, that's what I wanted to do. And I wanted people to have to question, well, how does a Hanover Place exist in the nation's capital? Right. And then who else is responsible for that?
Right.
Who else is accountable for what happened there? Because a lot of the things that, when you're not from that subculture, and I call it a subculture purposely, because when you're from that subculture, there's certain norms and rules and laws that exist there. It's not about if it's right or wrong, but it's just a explanation of what goes on there. That if you're not a part of that, you wouldn't understand it, but you're basing that on your understanding of how things should go in societal norms. And when you take a Tony Lewis, my dad, single parent household, mother, you know, would leave them at times with you know, people that they thought at that moment were strangers, and leaving for years, and, you know, go to sleep hungry. And what he started out as survival becomes, you know, his norm. Right. And he becomes good at it. And it's things that go on in that lifestyle that he's not proud of. But at the onset of this journey, it was him trying to survive with no dad and not the right guidance. It's not to take away his responsibility or his accountability for his actions. But again, I just wanted to explain, you know, and I saw it again with my friends who didn't have to go in the house at 10 years old, who dropped out in the fifth and sixth grade, you know, because their mother was addicted, but their dad never was there from the beginning. So when those people make choices, wrong choices, as young men and young women, I think society, I think America has to be courageous enough to start to say, okay, what role do we all play in these communities with that's void of opportunity, or these opportunities that people can see? And I think, you know, that's why I wanted to do in Slugg and talk about these individuals as people, you know, versus giving them these titles or these labels based on their decisions. So
you've been in this city and you've watched it change and you're watching it change. And so people on the outside looking in will think the gentrification is good for DC, and it's good that we're rolling over Hanover places, and we're going to soon be probably rolling over Sursum quarters and all kinds of places.
Yes.
But there were real communities in those places that sustained lives for generations.
Yes.
So as much as there were negative aspects there, a lot of people came out of those communities and they have loving relationships that sustain them to this day.
Yes.
How do you feel about watching your city change?
I'm scared to death, mm-hmm. and I'm excited at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to frame that. I'm scared because I see such a lack of inclusion. I feel like mm-hmm. sometimes the way of life of the native Washingtonian is completely being attacked. I feel like everything about what once existed here is looked at as being a bad thing. Mm-hmm. I see liquor stores getting shut down and bars being opened, which I can't really understand. I mean, if I see guns being legalized, weed being legalized, liquor stores that are open being open on Sunday, mm-hmm. these things that were once a part of, you know, supposedly all the bad and all the ills that existed in the city are now being considered to be amenities, only because the people utilizing the situations or utilizing the amenity is different, right?
Mm-hmm.
I see we're starting to understand clearly how a failed generation looks. Like when people, DC public school system, if people say that the school system failed its populace, we're seeing people can't get a job that went through that process. We're seeing people that that once had networks, built in networks and families and the lived in communities, they're just being dispersed all across, you know, the Mid-Atlantic region. And so that's the bad part of it. The great part of it, I see a city that's becoming diverse. I see a city that's so progressive, a city that has a ton of opportunity. Entrepreneurial spirit is at an all-time high. And I think those things are great things. I think it's going to be on us, though, to connect the dots. We have to be able to have a city where people that were born and raised here have just as much opportunity as somebody that's coming here from, you know, San Francisco or New York City. And right now, we're not seeing that. And I think that's something that it's not an easy task. I think it's very daunting, but I think it's something that's possible. I think we just have to create real systems, real workforce development systems.
Mm-hmm.
People need to be prepared for the jobs that are going to be the jobs of the future. We need to start earlier. We can't wait till people get out of high school. We need to start to support our D.C. residents that are off into colleges. I see so many young people that make it to college but don't finish.
Right.
All of these things play a part in being able to adapt to today's Washington. So yeah, and if nothing else, I want to be an example of somebody who can operate in both worlds.
Okay.
I take pride in being able to do that. I take pride in being able to help usher other people in, to connect people, and to create clarity. Because I think there's a lot of misconceptions about the native Washingtonian, and I think the native Washingtonian hold a ton of misconceptions about some of our new Washingtonians.
So, if I could FaceTime Tony Lewis Sr., and bring him into this space right now, what would he tell me about you?
About me?
How's he feeling about you? He's watching you.
Yeah,
he's watched you unfold.
He would say,
what would Dad say?
He'd tell me every day he's the proudest man in the world.
Mm-hmm.
He has a son that's made him proud, that's been able to ride this crazy roller coaster with him over 26 years of incarceration.
Mm-hmm.
He'll tell you there's a guy that's dedicated to his family, that he's happy I'm giving him a beautiful granddaughter. Mm-hmm. And and also he would say that he hopes that one day he'll be able to, have freedom again. Mm-hmm. I think that's, his ultimate wish. And I think he feels like my work and the things that I've been able to do can hopefully shine some positive light on him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what's the likelihood of him seeing freedom?
He has life without parole.
Right.
I'm excited about some of the bipartisan sentencing reform talk. I think some of it is still a bit off base because it's still being aimed at what they would call a low-level offender. Mm-hmm. But if you have things like draconian laws, those laws were wrong for anybody that was sentenced under them, like mandatory mm-hmm. minimums and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. So I think moving forward, though, those kind of conversations, fair sentencing acts of the world, two-point reductions will possibly give him an opportunity to at least have a shot at freedom. Okay.
So I want to thank you for joining us. Your story is amazing. It's one of the most complex reads that I think I've encountered. You cover so many different topics. It's like a sociological dig. I mean, you come at topics from really intimate places, but in ways that kind of shake the core of society. And I think that people really need to mine in ways that really tease out all of the threads. It's easy to stay focused on the drug piece.
Yeah.
But if people stay focused on the drug piece, they miss the story. Thank you for watching. Again, I'm April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. We are Contemporary Arts and Sciences Education, your dream, our guidance. Please follow us at #CASDreamers. Thank you.